Hello children, welcome back. We'll continue with the lesson, The Heavenly Parasol. Quickly, we will recall what we have learnt in the last class. We had seen that in a town called Prajyotisha, there was a beautiful princess named Amrita Prabha. And she chose Meghavahana to get married in Swayamvara. And when both of them moved forward to take the blessing of the king, that is Amrita Prabha's father, the priest and the king, both of them cried loudly, saying that the parasol of Varuna was casting the shadow over the prince Meghavahana. And the uniqueness of that parasol was it will cast only on the sovereign or the powerful one of the whole world. So Meghavahana was blessed with that parasol. Meghavahana brought that divine parasol and also the beautiful Amrita Prabha back to his home. And when he came back to home in Kashmir, the ministers of Kashmir, they offered him the throne because the king of Kashmir was always busy in prayers and he neglected the affairs of the kingdom. He did not take care of the kingdom. That is why all the ministers, they offered the throne to Meghavahana because he was brave and courageous. He accepted and Meghavahana became the king of Kashmir. And soon he proclaimed a law against the killing of living beings. So let us see what will happen next. Once while on an expedition near the sea, the king told his weary army to rest in the shade of some palm groves. "I must use this time to plan a way to conquer the island of Lanka," he thought. "It is the land of demons and needs to be taught the ways of peace. But how will I cross the great seas with my army?" Once, while on an expedition means journey with some particular aim. What was the aim here? To conquer the lands. So once he was on an expedition near the sea, his army were very tired. Weary army, W-E-A-R-Y, weary army. Weary means what? Tired. All the people in his army were tired. So Meghavahana told them to take some rest in the shade of some palm groves. Near some palm trees, he told them to take rest for some time. But he did not take rest. Meghavahana did not take rest. But instead, he started to plan to conquer the island of Lanka. You know, today Sri Lanka, same. So he wanted to conquer the island of Lanka. So he was making some plan so that he can easily conquer the island of Lanka. But many questions were coming in his mind. That was, how will he cross the great sea with his army? Water was the barrier. He could not move forward because water is there. He cannot cross also. So he was just thinking how he will cross the great sea with his army. And he was knowing that Lanka was the land of demons. Demons means where all evil and evil spirit people were there who don't hesitate to kill each other. So he wanted to teach them the way of peace and he wanted to impose his law there also. So he was just thinking how to reach Lanka. 11th paragraph. All of a sudden there was a cry in the air. It seemed to come from a wood by the shore, not far from where the royal horses were tethered. The cry came again and the king heard the plaintive call. "Even under Meghavahana's rule, I have been slain." So when the Meghavahana was just planning to conquer island of Lanka, suddenly what happened? He heard somebody screaming and crying loudly. He could hear the voice of some person crying loudly for help. He could not understand from where the sound was actually coming. It was not from very far. It was from somewhere nearby where his horses were
tired. His horses were taking rest. He could hear the voice, the sorrowful voice, saying that even in Meghavahana's rule, he is being killed. He has been killed. That means somebody was killing someone and he is asking for help. Even because he is telling even under Meghavahana's rule, because his law was against the killing of living beings. So that is why that person who is being killed, he was crying loudly and saying that I have been slain. I have been slain means they are killing me even under Meghavahana's rule. 12th paragraph. In his agitation, the king did not wait to summon his officers but ran towards the wood, plunging through the undergrowth. He fought his way till he came to the clearing. There before him was the temple of Chandika Durga, with some sort of human sacrifice in progress on the steps. A man lay on the ground and his arms raised for mercy, and a menacing looking barbarian stood over him, brandishing his sword. In his agitation means he was very much disturbed, the state of mind, he was very much disturbed by hearing this voice or this call for help. He did not wait for someone means he did not wait till he call all the officers. He just ran towards the wood, means there was a small forest, and he just ran towards the wood searching who was that person who was crying for help. Rushing through the undergrowth, he was going very fast and rushing, searching from where the call is being called. He fought his way till he came to the clearing. Finally, he reached the place from where the person was crying for help. And what did he see there? He saw a temple of Chandika or temple of Durga. And on the steps of that temple, there was some sort of human sacrifice was going on. You know, some kind of superstition people believe. Even now also people believe, but olden days it was too much that if they give some human sacrifice, then God will bless them or God will beat. All such kind of blind belief was there. So here also, on the steps of this Chandika temple, a man was laying down and he raised his arms, both hands he had raised, and he was asking for help. He was fearful, he's very much scared. And there were barbarians who stood near him. Barbarians, you know who are barbarians? Barbarians are the cruel human being. They don't hesitate to kill each other. These are barbarians. There were some fearful looking barbarians who were standing near him, brandishing his sword. Brandishing means what? Showing their sword. That means they were ready to kill that person who was laying down the steps. I have just given some pictures so that you will get how the human sacrifice was in progress.
"Stop," cried the king, shocked at the sight. "You wretch, you dare threaten another's life in my realm." The barbarian dropped his sword in terror and fell on his knees before the king. "Oh, noble one, have mercy. I am the leader of a troop of barbarians that live in this wood. My little son has fallen prey to some disease and is on his deathbed. If I kill this man, the gods will be pleased and save my son's life. If you prevent this sacrifice, my son dies and the rest of my troop will give up their lives with him." After hearing a voice, sorrowful voice, Meghavahana came near the Chandika temple and he saw that there was some sort of human sacrifice was going on. So he told them to stop that. And he also said, "You loser," he is telling to the barbarians who were about to kill the boy.
He said that you dare threaten another's life in my realm. That means in my rule, you are not allowed to kill anyone. So the barbarians saw the king Megavahana, and they were very much scared, and they just dropped their sword and they fell on his knees. His means who? Megavahana's knees. And they were requesting. They said that, please have mercy. Even they are also asking for some help. They said, there was a leader of the troop of barbarians. He said that they all live in that small forest, and that barbarian's little son had some kind of disease and he was on his deathbed. That means he was about to die. He was fallen prey to some kind of disease. And he says that if he kills a man or if he gives sacrifice, human sacrifice to goddess Chandika, then she will save his son's life. That means this is a superstition. Doing some human sacrifice and then believing that God will please them, this was a kind of superstition. So the barbarian says to the Megavahana that if he stops this sacrifice, then his son will die who is on his deathbed. The ailing son will die. Ailing means who is having some kind of disease. And he also says that after his son dies, his rest of the troop, all the people in his group will give away their life also. So this is a big confusion. Even the boy who was laying down on the steps of Chandika, even he is also asking for help. And even the barbarian also ask for help. 14th paragraph. The king glanced towards a bundle on the temple porch and presumed it to be the sacrificed boy. His heart was torn with confusion and compassion. When he saw the boy who was about to give his life as a sacrifice, they had tied him up. Then he understood, he saw that bundle and he understood that it was the boy who is going to be sacrificed. So after seeing this, he felt very bad. He had lot of sympathy, and he was in confusion what to do, whether to help that boy who is laying down or the barbarian who is asking for help for his ailing son. So this was really, he was in dilemma what to do, because both are asking for help. Paragraph 15. This man whom you desire to protect, continued the barbarian, was wandering about alone and friendless in the forest. Is he of more value to you than the child with whom many persons are connected? The barbarian is telling the boy who is laying down, he was wandering alone in the forest. He don't have any family, he don't have any friends, he don't have anyone. So he was just wandering in the forest. Nobody wants him. That is why he chose him to give sacrifice. So the barbarian is asking the Megavahana whether that boy who is wandering alone and friendless, who don't have any friends, is he of more value to you than his child who has many people whom he loves? So he's telling that he doesn't have anyone, that is why he has chosen him to sacrifice. The victim sat crying on the ground, a look of terror on his face. Tears fell from the barbarian's eyes. Sir, tell me what to do, he cried. I cannot see my son suffer this way. Here, victim is a boy who was lying on the steps of Chandika temple and who was offered as a religious sacrifice, that boy. So he's called as victim here. So the victim sat crying on the ground. Even the victim was crying. He was scared that he's going to lose his life. And even the barbarian who was about to kill that boy, even he was also crying. Why? Because Meghavahana is not allowing him to kill or not allowing him to give the sacrifice to goddess Chandika. So he is confused, he is worried now what to do. Paragraph 17. The king spoke firmly, "Do not be distressed. I will save your son as well as this victim. I offer my body in the sacrifice to Chandika. Kill me, O barbarian. May these two persons live." So after listening to both of them and after seeing the barbarian and the boy crying, he spoke firmly. He spoke very strongly. He said, not to get worried. He said, barbarian, not to get worried, because he is going, King Meghavahana is going to save both of them. He's going to save both their life. Even the boy who was lying on the steps of Chandika temple and also the son of barbarian. So he's going to save both their life. But how? Meghavahana said that he will offer his own body in sacrifice to Chandika. That means he is ready to die so that he can save both of them. So Meghavahana is telling barbarian, he is ordering barbarian to come, kill me, kill Meghavahana, so that these two people can live. Paragraph 18. The barbarian, struggling between incredulity and fear, took a step backwards. "Sir, you are the king. Your life should be protected all the times. Do not pity this victim. Let him die. His life is of no significance." So after listening to Meghavahana that he is ready to die so that he can save the life of the boy and the ailing son, the barbarian, he was struggling between incredulity and fear. Incredulity means some kind of disbelief. He was not believing. He was not actually believing what the Meghavahana is telling. And he also had some kind of fear within him. So what did he do? The barbarian, he just took a step backward. He went a little back and he said, "Sir." Sir means he is telling, referring to King Meghavahana. He is telling that you are the king and your life should be protected all the time. It's our responsibility that we need to protect your life. So don't pity on this victim. So he don't feel bad for this victim. Let him die because he doesn't have any family. He don't have any friends. He was wandering alone in the forest. He doesn't have anyone. So don't feel bad for him. Don't feel pity for him. Let him die. So the barbarian is once again requesting to allow him to give human sacrifice.
Children, will stop here today and I want you all to read the textbook till where I have taught. Thank you.